sure. So I actually deleted Snapchat. I have someone take care of my sheets because, you know, ending sheets with dopamine is kind of hard, but I haven't touched it in a very long, let's just say I haven't touched it in a very long time, and it has made my life so much easier. I have an app called Moment, and it counts how much time I spend on my phone every day. And I used to average 5 hours on my phone over, that was like average. Yeah, it's down to like 2 now, so it's very nice. But still a lot, that's nicer. Yeah. Okay, is anyone?
Oh,
yeah.
So personally, after doing research on this stuff, what I actually did was, not only did I delete Facebook, but I also keep my phone in a different room. So usually what I would do was, I actually bought an alarm clock.
You want $1,000?
Yeah.
Yeah, and for the record, he doesn't respond to my texts ever. Does anyone else have questions? Okay. I'm gonna let the panel introduce themselves, say a little bit about their own experiences with phone usage, phone addictions. So, I guess Rohan's right next to me. So, Rohan, you can start.
Hello, my name is Rohan, for those of you who don't know me, which is like none of you. I'm a junior, and for my personal experience with phone addictions, when Hubert and Shob first talked to me about joining the panel, the day after that, I also downloaded Moment on my phone, and I have been tracking my usage over the past week, and I checked it about 5 minutes ago, actually, and I noticed that I've, on average, in the past week, spent about 4 hours a day on my phone, which I was pretty upset about. And when I was thinking about this, I realized that this would account for the fact that I sleep at about 2 o'clock in the morning every day, and I'm consistently tired. So I think what Shob and Hubert have been talking about the science behind phone addictions, is really telling in the fact that, you know, a lot of us complain about how we don't get as much sleep as we would like, or we spend too much time doing homework. Well, I think if we put our phones away in a different room, give it to our parents, something, that would really help us be more efficient and be more useful with our time. Thank you.
I'm Lina, and I agree. I feel like I have 4 to 5 hours on a daily basis on my phone, and I feel like that's so much, especially considering the fact that 8 hours of your day go to sleep and another 7 are here at school, so like, where does that leave me spending my time? And I also realized that I finish all of my stuff at a very early time, like Shub mentioned in this presentation, but I end up sleeping so much later because I'm on my phone and I'm constantly responding to different text messages or looking through social media when I could really be using that time to do something else productive. And I feel like this is really important information that they shared, because it's important that we all like realize that what our phones are doing to our bodies in so many different aspects, and how we can use this information to now limit the amount of time we spend on our phone.
Hi guys, my name is Bhavesh, sorry. First, let's just thank Hubert and Shob for this amazing event. So I have it open right now for screen time. My screen time is 6 hours and 42 minutes a day. So yeah, I do overuse my phone a lot, and I think it was actually longer before until like I realized I use it too much. I still use it too much, obviously. But a lot of it goes into texting people and stuff, and playing games, and social media. I think that for me, it's just putting my phone away is just completely hard, because I get a notification every other minute, whether it be like my clubs, whether it be like my friends, whatever, right? So I think that this event is really important for all of us, because like every high schooler, no matter who you are, you use your phone, your laptop, whatever it may be a lot, right? So yeah, thank you.
That would be an idea.
Hi everyone, I'm Mia, I'm a junior. I think that for me, I do spend a lot of time on my phone. I feel like it stops me from even doing my homework. I kind of get home and I'm like, all right, you know, I had a long day at school. Let me just relax on my phone. Let me watch something. Let me text my friends. Yeah, and then it's like 2 hours later and I'm like, oh my goodness, I've been on my phone for like 2 hours, and it's crazy like where the time goes. And I'm sure that like some of you can relate. I mean, hopefully not, that's horrible. But but like, you know, it stops me from even wanting to do my work and like doing my work. So I feel like I don't like do my work early, I do it really late, or I wait until the next day, which is, don't do that, please don't do that. But you know, so I really want to, I always tell myself, I'm like, Mia, like you need to put away the phone, you really need to like do better with this. It's just, it is very hard. I find it really hard for me to like put down my phone and like keep it away from me. But yeah, that's my struggle. But hopefully, you know, I can work towards this. Hubert and Chu really inspired me, and I want to do better with it, so yeah.
Hi, my name is Brian. If you know me, I'm a freshman. There are three main things you probably know about me that almost everyone knows. So first off is I have a phone addiction. Secondly, I am the biggest procrastinator. And third, I don't get much sleep. And where do all these problems lie in? Well, today we finally came to the realization that it is phone addiction. My parents and my siblings are always telling me you're addicted to your phone. I said, no, I'm not. I'm just replying to a message. Like, I'll be done in a second. You're never done in a second. To prove this, I actually just looked a second ago. It's only 3:49. The majority of since last night, 12 o'clock, has been either spent sleeping or at school. And I'm at 4 hours and 17 minutes. And I'm not even home. Weekly is 7 hours and 34 minutes. That's not good. So, what do I realize here? I realize that every single time I may be doing something, I'm thinking about it. I'm thinking about it, I'm texting somebody about it. I'm posting about it. What am I doing? I should just be enjoying the time. I don't always think having a phone addiction is actually so bad. I think one good thing about potentially like posting when you're at someone, like when he had his example about going to the mall with his friends, and his friend was like, why are you posting that? So maybe it's a good way that you can keep memories, is if you like keep a camera roll with all the things that you've done with your friends when you look back on it. But does it really weigh, like, does the negatives and the positives really cancel out? I don't think so. I think that we can all do a better job, me personally. I think that we don't like to admit it, but we should, and it's not the worst thing in the world.
My name is Kyle Pizzano. I can definitely say that I'm addicted to my phone. One example is I'm a child, right? So when I practice, what I've noticed like for the past year is that like constantly when I'm practicing on my phone next to me, I'll practice for like 5 minutes and then I'll stop, check my phone. I don't know if this happens to you guys when you're doing your work too, but like you'll have your homework out, right? I tried doing this thing once. I was on my bed. I was doing my homework. I tried like throwing my phone across the room and like just like letting it sit there. And then I couldn't do like, I did like 2 math problems and then I walked up, picked up my phone, got back on the bed. So just something I experienced with phone addiction. I don't have like a cool story, Brian.
Hi, okay, this is loud. Sounds like I've never met a microphone before. Okay, my name is India, I'm a freshman. I know some of you, so that's cool, it's cool. For me, I'd say me using my phone, I'm not very addicted. Mia will know because I barely answer texts. I'm very bad, everyone's mad at me. But I won't say that I'm not addicted to my phone, I feel like I'm a lazy addict. Can there be levels? I'd say I'm like the lazy addict, rather than just addicted. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just down there. But I think I'm down there, but I'm still there. You know what I mean? Like, we should have, like, you know, a phone addict society where we all just be like, day one without my phone. You know? Well, I'm doing okay. But, like, yeah, I would text the group chat. I'd be like, guys, I went to the society today. Lit, you know what I mean? Yeah, but I feel like me and my phone, like, we have a bad relationship, but, you know, I really am addicted to my phone, because I'd say, like, even throughout the presentation, like, I was just like, is my, like, parents texting me? Like, I feel like there's a lot of factors, and I feel like our age group, refuses to accept the fact that we are addicted to our phones, because other age groups say that we're the only ones addicted to our phones. So we are just like, no, we're not addicted to our phone, because that's like a teen thing. But I think that's it's just a human thing, because, you know, with evolution, like, there's technology, like, you're not gonna not use the technology, you know what I mean? Like, but I feel like there's definitely ways that we can improve ourselves and our phones, and I feel like it's all technology, like, evolves us, but I feel like the number one, like, way that we can evolve ourselves is just having some time alone with ourselves. And I think that some people are afraid of that. Like, if they're not with their phone, like, who are they? You know what I mean? Like, who is my personality without my phone? I think that a lot of people have to face the facts, like, do you have a personality? Like, let's figure out what's on your phone. Like, let's all figure out. So I'd like to get to know you guys, you know what I mean? Without your phones. So, thank you.
People submitted questions, as I said before. So these are some of the questions that we would like to ask the panel. So you guys can just pass them through if you want to speak.
We can just do
email,
we're not gonna go on our phone to do the flip
point. Okay, so first question. What is your favorite social media platform and why?
Should we just call it out?
I have a mic now. So another question that was asked was, how do your parents enforce your phone addictions? Oh, enforce, yeah, your phone restrictions, not addictions. I don't want to take that.
So honestly, I feel like my parents never actually like say, oh, come back, get off your phone, blah, 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 right? Like, cause I feel like my parents trust me in like doing all my work and stuff. But I feel like at the end of the day, if I tell my parents to keep it stricter, like make sure I have all my phone as much and keep my phone away, I think that would work better for all of us. Let's say like you're doing an hour of serious work, right? If you give them the phone to say, oh, keep it away from me for an hour, they'll do it, right? So I think we have to realize that like, that's one way of getting rid of our form whenever we want, and I think I had to utilize that too.
So I've actually had this discussion, not just with my parents, but also with my sister, because she came home from college, and she's like, what are you doing? And I'm like, I'm on my phone. She's like, you have homework to do. So I said, what do you want me to do? So I didn't know about this, but there is something, if you have an iPhone, that's called guided access. Somebody else can put in a password, and it restricts you from doing most of the things you can do on your phone. Because at first, my sister's like, I'm taking your phone, you're going to do your homework. I said, well, I want to listen to music, because that's how I get my homework. She's like, all right, I got a way to do this. And she put on guided access, and I kept trying to log in, I kept trying to go on my Snapchat, I couldn't. So I was like, all right, you know what, I'm going to actually do my work now. I got my work done, I gave it back, and she unlocked it. And I was like, wow, like this would actually work. I think that most people, I didn't know about it. Most people don't know about this, and it would be a really good way to like limit phone addictions, I guess. So that you could like, it tells you what you can and cannot or are allowed to do until you change the passcode. If somebody has somebody else with the passcode, like, what are you gonna do?
I want to share my experience with this one too. My parents are probably, they think that I'm apparently addicted, which I may be, but it's beyond the point, because so are they. They're huge hypocrites. Oh my god. All Indian parents are huge hypocrites when it comes to this. Facebook, oh my god. Facebook's a big one.
The memes.
And they share WhatsApp. They share everything. Oh my god. They have 6 a.m. messages, 8 a.m. messages, 10 a.m. messages. It's they literally are on it every single minute. And the best part is, when I'm in the car, I see my mom talk to someone else. They're in contact with like 5 different parents at the same time. I don't know how they do it. So, honestly, I think I should put like restrictions on them.
I think I have a little something to share too. So, my mom loves to talk about her coworkers' kids. And let's just call them Monica and Monica's daughter. So she's like, oh, Monica's daughter puts her phone in like a basket the minute she gets home. And she doesn't touch it the whole day. She has to finish all her work. And then she just takes it to school. All she does is use it to call her parents. That's not true. I don't think that's true. You guys probably know that's not true, being teens. So, and she just, she always like yells at me to like put my phone like she always wants me to take my phone. And also with my brother, we have my brother's in college now. He's matured a lot in college. I'm very proud of him for that. But along with that, like maturity and everything, he also uses his phone less. Well, No, he still uses his phone. But he enforces it on me. So like I'm texting someone and like I like talking to this person. And he just takes the phone out of my hand, and he actually has some very good like things to like. We got in our biggest fights. I talked about like how like it affects my relationships with members of my family during my talk, and we've gotten our biggest fights because he's tried to get me to get off my phone. Whether it's because I was at like a very big family dinner or something, and I was just on my phone, and people were looking at me like, "This teen." So, you know, and he actually told me there's this thing called screen time, and you can set limits on apps. I don't know if that's what you were talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we use screen time. He puts do not disturb on, and there are ways that you can moderate it yourself, because like with screen time, you tap on an app and you use it too much, and it just has this big hourglass that just pops up, and you're like, whoa, like I'm in the middle of a conversation, but it just has too much effort. There's too much friction between like trying to get that, so it's just better that way. Yeah. Okay.
Have you ever felt that your phone is in your pocket, even though it's not there?
Wait. What do you mean?
Have you ever felt that even though your phone's not in your pocket, but you felt it is there?
Like,
you
go to check
for
your phone, even though you don't really
Yeah.
I've
had the opposite.
Oh,
That's fun. Yeah, so that happens to me a lot. And not even just with, like, checking to see if it's there, but also, like, if my phone is, like, my phone's like here, I'm like this all the time. And if nobody texts me, I'm still like this. When you see like who's looking, I do that all the time. Like if I feel like sometimes it's like, I think there's a word for it. It's like phantom, like notification, something like that. But like I swear I got a notification and I didn't. It's the weirdest thing, yeah. So
that happens to me a lot,
yeah.
Like another thing is when like you know when you like check for your phone and like it's there but you think it's not there and like that's like you get like a heart attack, like it's worse like failing a test or something. Like that shows how like bad phone addiction is for most of us. Like whatever and like you're like for most people important things are like family and stuff, but I feel like for me, for a lot of people here, it's your phone. Like if your phone's not there, you're not there. You know what I mean?
I like the liquor.
No, you.
Yeah. Alright. Use your phones in the bathroom and don't lie.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Usually, like, I wear AirPods right when talking to someone. No. And I meet them, and I can go up, and I go to the bathroom, and the airport is still in. And I'm always scared they're gonna fall in. And then like my phone's gone in the toilet once too, blah blah blah, etc. And then my mom's phone actually. But yeah, it shows phone addiction bad.
About being adventurous and trying new things.
My name is Justin Chung. I am a senior and I'm passionate about science, dance, and music.
My name is Mia and I'm a junior and I'm passionate about writing.
My name is Brian. I'm a freshman and my passion is sports.
My name is Rhea. I'm a sophomore and I'm passionate about reading.
Hi, my name is Hubert. I'm a junior and I'm passionate about people.
My name is Mary. I'm a freshman and I'm passionate about dancing.
My name is Danny. I'm a sophomore. I'm passionate about soccer.
My name is Madison Chu. I'm a sophomore, and I am passionate about making others happy.
My name is Winston, and I'm a senior, and I'm passionate about business.
My name is Catherine. I'm a junior, and I'm passionate about politics.
My name is Stephanie, and I'm passionate about softball.
And my name is Michael Norton, and I am a senior. I am passionate about engineering.
My name is Rachel. I'm a freshman, and I'm passionate about dance.
Hi, my name is Shubh Savani. I'm a junior, and I'm passionate about creating technology to help the world around me.
My name is Julia, I'm a senior, and I'm very passionate about music.
I'm Nikita, I'm a freshman, and I'm passionate about math.
My name is Michael Pacciulo, I'm a junior, and my passion is composing.
That's what life's all about, doing everything and anything you can possibly do.
It's very easy to get into it, you just have to be willing to put in the effort.
I can change the world through my words, and it helps connect me to my feelings and to other people.
Don't let anyone hold you back, because it's not about comparing yourself to others, it's about comparing yourself to be better than you were before.
Reading is so much more than a pastime. It actually helps people get through real-world issues.
You can be there for someone and make a difference on someone else's life. I think that's one of the most rewarding things.
Soccer is a good way to connect to other people that you don't usually talk to.
I know what it's like that. I really don't want others.
Business is actually a lot about collaboration and bringing people from different cultures together.
If you have a passion, you just have to go for it. If something seems outlandish, it's probably not, and you can achieve it.
I like helping like other kids, or other girls particularly, because it makes them feel stronger, like when they're playing sports.
We all find our passion. Life would just be easier for us, and work wouldn't seem like work.
I'm able to express myself in like every way.
Technology connects us to people around us, It also allows us to make scientific discoveries that we never thought possible. And lastly, it allows us to improve the lives of people with disabilities.
I want to talk about how math can be enforced in life and how it is relevant.
It's a way to really express like my thoughts and feelings.
Welcome to Herricks X.
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 Uses their phone most in your family? I'll take it first.
Oh no, I'll just move my hands back.
Oh, cool.
I feel like I definitely do use my phone most in my family. Like, as she was saying, like, our parents use it a lot too, but I feel like they use it more on like a communications perspective and they don't waste their time on it. Like, we have things to do when, like we have homework, we have tests to study for, right? Like, but all we do is just stay on social media, stay on Instagram, stay on Facebook. And I think that's the wrong aspect of doing, like, yeah, that's what cell phone addiction is. But, like, if you have no work to do, right, and you can communicate with people, you can talk to people about, like, the day and whatever, I don't think that's a form of cell phone addiction. But, yeah.
So, I actually think that I might not be the person who uses the phone most. My family, I think it might be my mom.
when I might think that I'm the one who uses the, my phone the most unproductively. I think that I know my mom, due to her job, has to check her email every 5 to 10 minutes. And it's part of her job because she's constantly getting updates on a new case, she's a lawyer, potentially how something is going, and she has to constantly check. So she's always yelling at me to get on my phone. I say, well, Mom, you're on your phone too. I think you're on your phone than I am. But I think that we don't realize that the time we spend could be doing something better, whereas sometimes other people have to spend that time specifically for them.
Yes, this will be a sister because she's only in 7th grade, and that shows how bad it's gotten. She's the one who watched Netflix and Snapchats with her friend a lot. She's spent a lot of time on her phone. Soccer so that you can hang out with your friends. If your teammates are your friends, you're technically doing the same thing. So you know, soccer, you know, it doesn't have any effect on our school. It doesn't affect our grades, anything. So you could say it's unproductive, but is it really? We don't put it into that category because it's not on our football. So
I feel like the driven narrative is that anything done at home or online is considered unproductive, and that you should be spending your time outside. But you could be having the same needs of communication, just doing different things on your phone or inside compared to being outside. So is there really, besides the physical benefits, is there really any other benefits?
Sorry, we're gonna have to move on to the next question. Sorry. So the next question is, are you proud of your social media profiles? Like your Instagram profile, are you like proud of like what you have? Are you proud of your followers or any of that? Like are you like if people look at your profile, would you be like, yeah, that's my profile?
Based on the number of followers I have. I'm not proud of my feed, but that's just because I post pictures that I like, not tried to build my self-esteem based on my internal beliefs and my internal accomplishments, not necessarily the number of things about like my pictures. And I think, as Amina had stated before, that social media is kind of bringing down people's self-esteem. You're sitting there face-tuning, using VSCO, using every single Photoshop you could possibly think of to help articulate who you are as a person, to help get those likes and get that attention. But that's not necessarily what dictates you being a good person and you having that internal self-confidence.
Snapchat has a feature that gives you a snap score. Snap score is however many Snapchats you have either sent or been sent. I, out of my group of friends, have by far and away the highest snap score. What does this mean? Does this mean I had Snapchat first? Possibly. Or does it mean that I spend the most time on it? Possibly. I think that while we've discussed all the negative aspects of social media, I think that, me personally, sometimes I get a lot closer to people on social media. I start talking to people I wouldn't normally talk to. I add somebody on Snapchat, they add me back, and just recently I started talking to a couple of other people that I met because of it. And now I have a much greater relationship, and I say hi to them always. So I really do think that it can enhance.
I personally don't know if it's a good or bad thing that we do that, but there's something to be said about, you know, portraying who you are on your social media account.
I feel like my social media account is only a facet of who I am, because you can only see so much. You don't know what kind of personality I have in my pictures, but you can see some of the things that I'm interested in and like who my friends are and things like that, but that doesn't speak to who I am as a person.
I'm going to say one thing really good. Let's put this into perspective. Something on your Instagram, tell me you did not also go on your Snapchat and say, like my Instagram post. What does that show you is that people like, they're really so far into it that they share it as much as possible just to get attention.
It's because of dopamine. It's 4:30 and someone's going home. But it's time to wrap things up. So for our panel and for our event. So basically, just the first of our many events, and we want to. We hope that you guys like this, and we hope that you guys are inspired to, you know, talk about your passion in future talks and to pursue it. So this is why we're going to be, as soon as possible, we're going to send out a form to all the grades, and we're going to. Basically, it's going to state on like whether you want to give a future talk and like what we talk about.
Yeah, we're really happy with your excitement today, and we hoped you took something out of our talks, but the whole point of this is not for you to just simply learn about like social media or phone addiction, so that's pretty nice too. But we want you to be able to want to give your own talk, because that's the whole point of this. We want to bring Herricks together, and we're going to send out a form as soon as possible. Thank you guys for coming, and have a nice day.
You stated that you had the highest snap score. You guys did that long, because all on the snap score.
Saying out of the guys.
You're proud of your snap score. You're looking more wise. You're president.
Just to clarify, we'll have forms about, just like for future talks, we're gonna have forms about ideas that you want, but for every event, we'll probably have a panel and people who talk, so just send what you're interested in. Thank you. All right, see you guys.
As some of you may know, I'm Shosvani.
And I'm Hubert Zo, and we're both juniors here.
See, I had an amazing idea.
Now what is that, Shook?
Imagine if students can share and talk about topics they're passionate about and interested in.
Wait a minute. That sounds like a really good idea.
Really?
Yeah. Imagine if students can explore, create, and share their ideas.
What would you talk about?
Personally, I would talk about my passion for helping people or social media, because as you know, I pretty much live on Snapchat. How about you?
I would talk about technology, but more specifically, how it impacts our lives.
Wow, that sounds pretty interesting.
That is awesome. I wonder what other students are more passionate about.
I'm a junior, and I'm passionate about creating technology to help the world around.
I'm a
life's all about, doing everything and anything for positive. I can change the world through my words, and it helps connect me to my feelings and to other people.
Don't let anyone hold you back, because it's not about comparing yourself to others, it's about comparing yourself to be better than you were before.
Reading is so much more than a pastime. It actually helps people get through real world issues.
You can be there for someone else's life. I think that's one of the most rewarding things.
Soccer is a good way to connect to other people that you don't usually talk to.
Business is actually about collaboration and bringing people from different cultures together.
If you have a passion, you just have to go for it. If something seems outlandish, it's probably not. You can achieve it.
I like helping like other kids, or other girls particularly, because it makes them feel stronger.
All find your passion. Life would just be easier for us, and work wouldn't seem like work.
I want to express myself in like every way.
Technology connects us to people around us. It also allows us to excite and discovery that we never thought possible. And lastly, at last, the life of disabilities.
I want to talk about how math can be enforced in life and how it is relevant.
It's a way to really express like my thoughts and feelings.
Welcome to Herricks X.
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 Welcome to Herricks X. Welcome to Herricks X. So you're probably wondering, what Herricks X is? Herricks X is a platform for students to give talks similar to TED Talks about topics that they're passionate about and interested in.
Afterwards, students who have volunteered to be on the panel will answer questions from the audience members in an open mic style discussion about the topics that we're talking about.
Our first talk will be given by Hubert Zoe on the topic of how social media tells our story. So without further ado, please give a round of applause for Hubert.
Sorry, just give me a minute. I'm not here today to lecture you on how to live your lives. I'm here to show you all the amazing capabilities of this old big thing called social media. I've heard from some super reliable social media users that social media actually allows us to spend even more time off of our homework and being unproductive. If you thought that video games and Netflix would have done that, you couldn't be more wrong. A recent study showed that the average Android user spent 58.5 hours on Facebook and minutes, 53.2 minutes on Instagram, and 49.5 minutes on Snapchat every single day. That's an incredible amount of screen time dedicated to other people. Social media is clearly a winner, but if you think that's all, you couldn't be more wrong. Social media is also letting teens detach themselves from reality. 44% of teens say that they get frustrated with their friends because they're on their phones so much while they hang out together. Sound relatable? If it isn't you, it's someone you know. And don't be embarrassed by it. Social media is just efficient in doing its job. Letting billions of users and wasting just as many hours of people's lives, social media is truly a game changer. Now let's be real here. Snapchat, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, social media plays into all of our lives in various different forms. Whether we're sharing our stories through pictures, videos, status updates, texts, or even comments and reactions, We made an image of ourselves online that reflects part of who we are or want to be. And there's no doubt that social media brings a lot to the table. I personally have used social media to my advantage to meet new people through friends and to form an image of my own. If you haven't already done so, picture social media as a world apart from your reality. Think of a friend, relative, or acquaintance that you know from both worlds, and try to erase what you know of them from reality, leaving just their online imprint. Do you still see the same person? Chances are that the person you see is not the same person you know in reality. From the captions, comments, and stories that users put out, what they want people to see, and without real context, this could be really misread by the people who see it. Have you ever asked for advice for a caption because you wanted to seem funny or easygoing? My bet is that you've either asked or helped someone else in order to pick out a caption that will mold your image in the direction that you wanted it to be. Have you ever deleted your comment because you didn't want it to seem weird? You aren't the only one. I delete my comments all the time, whether it was because I didn't want to make the same joke as someone who beat me to it, or just because I thought my comment would be plain weird. I've had my fair share of instances where I've used social media to my advantage to form a better image of myself online than I could ever imagine myself becoming in person. I count my followers to make myself seem more wanted than wanting. I retake pictures if the lighting is bad. I don't text twice if someone didn't respond the first time, unless I'm extremely comfortable with them. And I take pictures of the best moments of my life to make people think that my life was better than it was. So it was just an ordinary day, and I had finished my first 10 minutes of laying in bed scrolling through Facebook, when all of a sudden, I heard a ding. It was a text from my mom. Now that's not good. Here's some fun facts about my mom. She's an amazing cook. She works harder than anyone that I know. She loves working with kids. And most relevant to me, a text from her is 80% not a good thing. So for those of you who know the social media meme, I usually try and respond almost instantly. And it's pretty much a reflex to tap every comment and every notification that pops up on my screen. So naturally, I opened her message. Great. Now I had to look at the article she sent me. 7 signs that your teen is addicted to social media. 1. They check their phone first thing in the morning. Check. 2. They frequently check their social media platforms. Check. 3. They often can't enjoy activities without sharing it to the world. Check. 4. Their friends use it to get in touch with them. Check. 5. It's the first choice in how they spend their free time. Check. 6. They neglect their responsibilities. Big check. 7. Their relationships with other members of the family is affected by it. Okay, check. Okay, so I was addicted to social media. Big deal. It's not like it would affect my life too much, right? So I was hanging out with a few of my friends once at Russo Field, you probably know it, and almost by instinct, I took out my phone and put them on my story, and I'll never forget this. One of them says, yes, let's let everyone know every time we do something social. For those of you who may know me, I'm no fan of sarcastic jabs at my character, but this one rendered me speechless. I was able to pick myself up afterward because all my other friends were doing it, so there's no shame if everybody's doing it, right? But he wasn't wrong either. I began to question myself. Do I really care if people see what I'm doing or if I'm doing something? Well, the answer is actually yes. No matter how hard students try to play their addiction to their images off as indifference, we all do care. It will always be something that we're going to think about. And I'm sure someone out here is thinking, well, I wouldn't care if that person didn't look at my picture. And maybe there are those people that you really don't care about, though I could argue you do. However, there are always people that you're commenting for, fixing your hair for, and even people who don't post at all and just simply watch. That's the image that you're promoting for yourself. That's the story that you're telling. And the sad truth is, very few students are actually indifferent to this disease. Making an image for yourself with a few taps and a funny comment is just the easiest way to promote ourselves. So much easier than just keeping your head held high in person. Judging the stories of others is so easy because all you see is the shell that they put out into the social media world. So take that break from Snapchat. Mute your phone while you're hanging out with your friends. And join me in reality. Because this story that we're telling has become our reality. And it's up to us to write our own stories and to write them for ourselves. Thank you. Okay, so that was my talk. And next up, we have Shobh Savani with his talk on the science behind phone addictions. Wow.
Wants to get high. Yeah? You guys up for some? Excellent. Let's see what we have here. This is the best of the best. This stuff will make you forget about all your problems. That calc test that you failed, forget about it. That science research mentor that you still haven't found, forget about it. That Scardina essay that you still haven't started, forget about it. Because this stuff brings endless happiness and endless entertainment. Who's up for some?
Hit me up.
Hi, my name is Shobh Savani. I'm a junior, and today I'm going to be talking about the science that goes behind phone addictions. But before I get into the specifics of what goes on in our brains when we use our phones or interact with someone who is using their phone, let me show you something. Because not many of us realize how serious it is when I say, we are all addicted to our phones. Now, if I were to hold my phone and talk to all of you like this, no, I'm not checking it, it's not buzzing, and I'm not even looking at it, but I'm still holding it like this, would you feel like you are the most important thing to me right now? No. The answer is simple. Obviously not, because there's a subconscious feeling within our brains that when these devices are out. Because when it is out, it makes everyone else around me feel less important. Now, some of you might find this a bit confusing. Don't worry. Even when I first heard about this, I was in disbelief. I mean, how could a phone make everyone else feel less important? I mean, that is crazy. It's ridiculous. Am I right or am I right? I think I'm right. However, for most of you who still may not understand this phenomenon, let me show you another example that will hopefully clear things up.
If I were to walk in a hallway, and I was using my phone like this, and my friend comes up to me and says, hey, and I was like, hey, and I go back to my phone like this, do you think he felt important? Do you think that he felt hurt? Let me show you another example, and it's going to be the same scenario, but I'm going to change something up a little bit. Now, if I were also in a hallway, and I was checking my phone like this, and my friend comes up to me and says, hey, and I take my phone, I put it in my pocket, and say, hey, what's up? Which one do you think he felt more important?
Exactly.
Probably the second one. Exactly.
Because, again, there's a subconscious feeling when our phone devices are out. It makes everyone else around us feel less important. Here's another example. When our friends and I were hanging out at our favorite local Mexican restaurant, Taco Bell, because where else would we go? An interesting thing happened. When one person pulled out their phone, it made everyone else feel uncomfortable. It made everyone else feel stupid. So what do? Like everyone else, we also pulled out our phone, and we started to use it. Some of us may feel that you don't do this, or that this problem isn't even prevalent, but studies show that 85% of smartphone users will check their devices while talking to someone else. And if you still don't believe me when I say that most people have phone addictions yet, listen to this. One in every three people take their phone to the bathroom. And one in every five people drop their phone in the toilet. Now, if you can't even put your phone away while taking a dump, I don't know when you ever will. So, now that we realize how bad our promise is, I think it's time to take a look at what's going inside our brain and see why these devices are just so damn hard to put away. Why we spend hours on our phones instead of playing outside, instead of going out with our friends, instead of learning something new. I mean, why is it that the average person touches your phone an estimate of 2,617 times a day? It's because software developers and tech companies design our devices to tap into our brains and do something really nasty. They mess with something they really shouldn't. Our dopamine activity. Dopamine. Now, that's where it's at, because historically, dopamine is a great chemical. It's what's caused us to become evolved, to create great civilizations that we live in today. In fact, back in the caveman times, dopamine was used as a great incentive to motivate us to hunt, to create shelters for ourselves, and to interact with one another. However, today, with the increasing usage of our phones, our dopamine levels are off the charts, as our brain are now becoming hardwired to crave dopamine. And today, there's no better way to put it, but we are turning into this. Most of you are probably unaware of the numbing effects of dopamine, but dopamine is extremely prevalent. In fact, I can guarantee you that you felt it today. When we take a bite of delicious food, we get a bit of dopamine. But after we exercise, we get another hit of dopamine. And also, when we get texts on our phone, we get hit. It feels good. It's because of dopamine. This also explains why when we get a like on Instagram, we feel good inside. It's because of dopamine. And it also explains why when we get another follower, we feel good inside. It's because of dopamine. And so what's happening is that after constant hits of dopamine every single day, every single minute of our lives, our brains are craving dopamine, and we cannot live without our devices. This is why when we lose our phones, even for a second, we turn from this into this. This is why we refuse to talk to our friends for a week when they screw up our snap streaks. Or the 400, and they decide to forget one day? Man, the nerve they have. Now, let's take a further look at the pathway dopamine takes within our brains. As you can see, there are three distinct pathways within our brain that dopamine takes. And as we use apps such as Instagram and Snapchat, all three of these pathways become active immediately. Since our brain is either anticipating or experiencing rewarding events. In other words, our brain associates the rewarding events, such as a like on our post, or another viewer on our Snap story, as a hit of dopamine that follows. And this feedback reinforced within our brains after spending almost three hours on our phone has led to an influx of dopamine surging through various parts of our body associated with learning, habits, and most of all, addiction. This tactic has also helped casino owners lure people into gambling more. For instance, for people who play slots, their dopamine pathways immediately start to light up, as from the moment they push that lever to the second that the machine stops spinning, dopamine is surging through their brain from their midbrain to their prefrontal cortex. So, many people think we're screwed. We're hopeless. Maybe it's because we stay up till 1 a.m. doing our homework. Maybe it's because we spend hundreds of hours on social media. To be honest, I don't know. But I do know this. I don't think we're hopeless. I don't think we're screwed. As a person who wants to work with technology in the future, I believe that the benefits greatly outweigh the costs. So, only question remaining is, what do we do with these things? We can't just stick them down a garbage disposal. So, what do we do next? How do we cope with them? Well, the first step in solving any problem is by identifying it. Hopefully, after these two talks, you realize that most, if not all of us, have phone addictions. Of course, there are some greater than others. Now, in order to make this work, we only need to make small changes in our lives. Very few. And there's no better place to start than at the dinner table. Because studies have shown that 1 in 3 Americans use their phone during meal times. One change we can all do is to put our phones away while eating. As a person who watches Netflix and YouTube while eating, I can tell you, it brings you problems. Because as you're binging Office episodes and Friends episodes, we forget about what we're even putting into our bodies. This makes us eat even more than what we can handle. Now, we all have complained, either now or in the past, about not getting enough sleep. However, we blame it on the amount of homework that we get, and we blame it on our teachers. And sometimes that may be the case. However, most of us finish our homework at around 10 o'clock, but we don't go to sleep until midnight because we're too busy binging on Friends episodes. So, what's the solution? Keep your phone in a different room. Oh, but my phone is my alarm clock. I need it. Sweetie, look, I'll buy you an alarm clock. It's $11 on Amazon. Look, I'll show you. So, please keep it in a different room because it's going to tempt you to waste time. And as a result, studies have shown that there's adverse side effects with this that come with using your phone before going to bed, including depression and anxiety, as less sleep leads to feeling less alert when you wake up, making you unprepared to tackle the day. So next time you complain about not being able to finish your assignment, or not being able to get enough sleep, or that your stomach aches because you ate too much, be aware that it is because of the excess amount of dopamine that's flowing within our bodies. So personally, my prescription to all of us is to end our streaks with dopamine.
Okay, hello. So, we hope you like those two talks, and right now we will be having a panel discussion. On the panel, we have a few kids from every grade going up. So, could I have India, Brian, Rhea, Kyle, Avina, Rohan, Mia, and Bhavesh. Could I have Bhavesh? Thank you. So basically, what this panel is it will be a discussion on how... Okay. If you guys need another chair, there's a chair over there. So it'll be a discussion on social media, phone addictions. Some people, we sent out a form actually pretty recently, and people sent questions on something they wanted to ask about just because they were curious or other things. And you guys will also have the opportunity to ask your own questions because this is an open mic discussion. We want everyone to be involved. So, perfect. So, does anyone have any questions they want to start off with? Yes, Mark. Do you want the mic or do you want can like screen?
Given the information in your own studies and research,